Hi, and welcome to School of Hustle. I'm your host, Sarah, and this is the show where we chat with everyday entrepreneurs about everything that goes into starting a new venture. Throughout the many episodes of this show, I've interviewed entrepreneurs in all stages of their journey. And today I am thrilled to introduce a serial entrepreneur that has achieved an elite level of success not commonly achieved. Alain Cohen is the CEO and co-founder of OPNET Technologies, which he built from the ground up and eventually sold for $1 billion. He's an inventor on more than 60 patents relating to software, networks, electronics, algorithms, and simulation, and has a degree in electrical engineering from MIT. He went on to become the CEO and co-founder of Bublup and COBRO Ventures, plus sits on the board of directors at C4 Therapeutics. Today, we're going to sit down with him to learn how he built his empire and what advice he may have for aspiring entrepreneurs. Welcome to the show.
Oh, nice to meet you.
I mean, it is such a pleasure to meet you because I'm so familiar with one of your ventures, which is Bublup. I use it literally every day, so thank you so much for creating that. I'd love to just hear your story because you've achieved the level of success that most entrepreneurs really dream of. So can you just tell me, like, how did you get started?
I'll tell you that as a child, I was already interested in business. I was just like a lot of kids. I had the proverbial lemonade stand. Then I, you know, enhanced it and started selling arts and crafts. I wanted to make more money at my lemonade stand.
And it's so funny you started that way. I love that. Yeah. It's like so typical. And then, now look at you.
And then eventually my family moved back to France where I was born. And there I took up stamp collecting. And I would go to the stamp market in Paris by myself, you know, as a 7 or 8 year old. I would go and I'd buy stamps and then I would sell them to other kids who are interested in stamp collecting, of course, for a profit. So
how old were you at this point?
7, 8, 9.
Entrepreneurship runs in your blood, it seems.
And then, I always had it in the back of my mind that I like this idea of running my own business. I guess it was just a matter of time before I found another idea. And when I was in school at MIT, I was in a class. I had a graduate project on data networking. And it was kind of the early days of the internet and networking was a really hot field. And I thought, what could I do in this field that would be innovative? And I came up with an idea for a project. The class required a project. And that eventually became my thesis. And then after I graduated, I told my brother, I said, you know, there's something here. We can start a business with this. And I'm very lucky to have my brother, Mark, with whom I do everything. We do all of our businesses together. We're a team.
Yeah. You guys have co-founded 3 businesses together. Is that correct?
We've had quite a few businesses together and continue to do that. And so we decided that, we would make a, you know, we could have a go at turning this project that I had started in school into a business. And then we just slowly grew the business. And one of the points I'll make later talking about how to get started in the beginning, we took on a few investors. You know,
how did you do that? How did you get the investors? And I believe you started this business in 1986.
Yes, that's correct. So, you know, we talked to people we knew, you know, some people weren't interested. Some people thought we were crazy. And then, but we weren't asking for that much money. We were trying to get $25,000 together.
And what was that funding for initially? Just investing in equipment or what did you use the funding for?
Yeah. Buying some equipment, buying some computers. Okay. It was a software project. So we needed some computers. But for about a year, we worked on turning it into a product. And then, of course, we needed to do a little marketing. But everything was done on a shoestring budget.
So this is for OPNET. Can you briefly explain what OPNET does in the most simplistic terms possible?
Well, in the very beginning, OPNET was a product by geeks for geeks. It was apparently something we would sell to other engineers, and it was used by people who were working on the fundamental technologies of the internet and of data networks. And so in order to develop those things, they needed a way to prototype and simulate those capabilities that they were creating without having to build the real thing first. And so,
right, because it's way more expensive to do that whole thing.
Yeah, kind of like when engineers build a bridge, they build a model of it first. You see,
that's exactly what I was thinking of. Yeah, it's like architecture. Exactly. You build a miniature version of a skyscraper, and then once you like the idea, you build the real skyscraper.
Exactly, you got it. So here you're testing how the system is going to work and run and behave. And so people used it a lot, you know, in the beginning to engineer everything from telephone networks to networks on the space station, the networks on an airplane, and the internet itself, some of the what we call protocols that are in the internet itself. And in fact, GoDaddy was a customer of ours.
Really?
Yes, absolutely.
Oh, look at that. It comes full circle.
Yeah, so we grew it, and then our product started catching on, and all the big service providers like GoDaddy, like AT&T, like Verizon, they were all using it. And so it grew and grew, and we started creating new products. So by the time we were done, we probably had about a dozen products, including hardware products that were used to monitor networks, et cetera. So
how long did this take from your first customer to your first 10 customers?
Oh, well, that probably took about a year. And then eventually we found some people were interested in investing in our company. We were interested in going public as a company. Yeah. And we knew that to go public, it would be good to have some people who had that kind of experience before. So we brought on some late stage venture capital, people who obviously knew what they were doing in terms of taking a company public.
How many years did that take you to go public?
About a dozen years before going public.
Okay.
And then after we went public in 2000 during the time where the stock market was having a huge crisis. The bubble was at that point, popping. Once we did get out onto the market, we did great. And we were one of the top 10 IPOs of the year. And, you know, we had a lot of interest in the company.
So in 2012, you actually sold the company for $1 billion, which is unreal. Congratulations on that.
Thank you.
How? Let's just tell me everything about that, please.
Well, there were people interested in buying the company. We also felt that it was a good time for the company to maybe be part of a bigger, part of a bigger platform, so we could have sales worldwide. For example, we had been selling worldwide, but not as much as we could. There's so much more market share we could take in Japan, in China, in Australia, where we had a small presence overseas. So to be part of a bigger platform would create value.
Can you talk about a few of those things that you think are absolutely essential to bringing a business from literally your mom's house to a $1 billion company?
We were the real garage shop.
I love that.
Yeah. Well, like I said, all of those steps that went in between, of course, I think some of the key things that happen along the way are the people that you add to your team. You're not going to get there by yourself. You might have some companies where I think, the management or the CEO is, has, let's say, a style which is very draconian, and it's my way or the highway. And I think that probably lessens the chance of success. It can still work if you have an incredible vision everybody's working on, and if the market is right and people are there for the money and they see that it's happening, and people might stick around. But not every business has all of those things. And in some businesses, you need the team to persevere through tough times, like you were saying. You have crisis you have to go through. And so having that team dynamic, to me, is going to increase the chance of success. And having people who get along and work well together and aren't so ego-driven, but are wanting to be part of a bigger something.
How do you find them? That's for me, hiring people has been such a process for my business. Do you have any advice on how to hire the ideal person? person for a specific role?
First of all, we never have an interview that lasts less than a day. I mean, it's always at least a day. And
how do you make it last that long? Because I feel like most interviews today are 30 to 60 minutes, and then
how can you get,
which is why a lot of the time things don't work out.
Yeah, because you haven't really gotten to know much about that person, right?
No.
I mean, first of all, the last thing you want to do is go over their resume and ask them to repeat what's on their resume, right? So what you want to do is dig into some of the things that are on their resume that you think were the most important. And see if they can talk about them in an articulate way, in a way that proves they really did those things and they were really involved in those things and they weren't just part of some group of people who did it and they were just kind of a bystander. I think you have to also do some kind of a mock situation, at least one or two, where you have them do what they're gonna do in their job, okay?
Yeah.
So you can observe and you can see how they react. It might be a little bit contrived, it's okay. In our case, a lot of our products are tech products. We're doing, you know, we're creating software. And so.
So do you have them do a test?
Yes, absolutely. We have, you usually do around 3 or 4 during the day.
Really?
We have some interviews where it's not a test, but then at least 3 or 4 problems that they have to solve in real time. We give them 30 minutes, go do something. And then we talk about it. It's not about getting it right or wrong. It's about how their thought process, you know, turns out to be.
Oh, interesting. So for you, if they get it wrong, it's not an end game.
Yeah,
it could just be explain to me why you did it this way.
Right. And can you think of a better way to have done it? And if I point out a problem to you, maybe you couldn't see the flaw in it yourself, but then if I point out a flaw or an improvement, could you then take it to the next level by yourself? So like just to have a discussion with somebody and you see if, you know, we're kind of similar, not necessarily similar thinkers, but if they're familiar with those kinds of thought processes that are important in your company.
Yeah. So what about this situation? They're really good at what they do, but you just don't get along with them.
This is a problem. I mean, I guess you'll have to decide if it's fixable and maybe give it a few attempts at fixing it. I have definitely fixed some situations.
Yeah.
You have to get to the heart of why it's not going well in terms of interpersonal. Usually the problems I've had to fix would have been interpersonal among other people, not with me.
Do you have any tips on managing people and working through challenges like that?
Yeah, well, first of all, if you do have a challenge like that, I would say, like I said, you got to find out what's really going on. People,
what's the root of the issue?
Yeah, what's the real rub between these different people, you know? And sometimes it could be an ego problem. Sometimes you have to kind of separate people and have them work separately. I've done that successfully, had them work on different areas of the company, and then they each have their own little turf. But ideally, you want to avoid these people with huge egos to begin with, okay, if you can.
You also, before we had this interview, you mentioned the importance of staying motivated and growing a company.
Yeah.
Sometimes this can be really hard, especially when you don't see successes, or if you have so much success, like what you had, that you're kind of like, why do more? I just made $1 billion.
Well, why not retire, right?
Right. Why not retire?
Well, and I don't get to do fun things.
So how do you remain motivated is the question.
Yeah. You know, what keeps me motivated is what has always kept me motivated from the beginning is if I still haven't lost that interest in taking an idea from its inception all the way to reality and then, you know, testing it out there in the world. So that whole process of the creative process is what gives me the biggest high that I can have.
Yeah.
You know, you have an idea. It all starts in one moment. It's incredible to believe. I can still remember the moment I thought about the idea that launched the company that we sold for $1 billion. It only takes a second. And then be careful, because in 1 second you could determine the next 20 years of your life.
That's so scary when you put it like that.
That is true, though.
It's true.
It's true, right? And that's true for so many things in life. But
oh my gosh,
you got to be careful what you think about during that second.
So how do you direct yourself to the right decision? I mean, there's so many ideas that pop in our heads as entrepreneurs, yeah. and yeah. how do we know when we're pursuing the right thing, and what should we pay attention to when we're starting a business?
I mean, yeah, you have to have, hopefully, you know, you have a good head on your shoulders and you can reason about whether or not this idea has really has legs. Can it get somewhere? Is there a, like, you know, is there a market? Will people be interested? Why are they going to be interested? Test it with other people. Talk to people. Don't live in isolation. You know, you want to challenge yourself. Don't just drink your own Kool-Aid. So for a while in the beginning, you need to be thinking, does this really have an opportunity to succeed? And then what about the competition? There's so many things that can cause you to fail. And then there's another problem, of course, which is raising money. And, you know, do you have enough money?
Yeah, it's very challenging for most people raising money.
Absolutely. And another word of advice to early entrepreneurs, I think is really important is, you know, be skeptical about your own plans. Everybody has like a 2-year plan and a 5-year plan and so on. Well, first of all, when you're in the very beginning, 5-year plan's not very meaningful. You know, the first 2 years are going to change your 5-year plan. So see if you can get out to market and selling your product. You know, that's maybe a 2-year plan. Depends on what your business is, of course. But you need to be skeptical of your own plan. And everything takes longer than you think. And everything is harder than you think. And everything is more expensive than you think. So you can just go ahead and multiply everything by 2 or 3 right off the bat.
It's so true. So sad, but so true. So what are some specific pitfalls that people should look out for when they're starting a business?
Yeah, I think that that's one of them. I think another one is that's pretty important is if you get investors and people who believe in you, some people are so grateful to have those investors and that they're ready to give away the farm. And so they start giving away so much stock in their company that they don't even realize that there's going to be another round of investment later, and then probably another round of investment later. And by the time they're successful, they might own such a small percentage of their own company that they're not even really in the control position anymore. And so as a result, other people could actually take your baby away from you.
To what extent is success in entrepreneurship about the financial rewards?
Money is good for many things. You know, it's a universal currency, obviously. So it's good for many things. Part of it is your own lifestyle, there's no doubt. But also part of it is what you can then do with it on the next round. You can start new businesses, okay? And then, okay, so you might say, well, that's just kicking the can down the road. You're just getting more money. What are you gonna do with that? But the point of it is that you can have an impact on the world in various ways. There are so many great causes in the world. You know, there are so many people who are less fortunate. There are so many people who unfortunately have been afflicted by a disease. There are people who need help with so many different situations in their life. And it is a tremendously satisfying thing to be able to have an impact on other people's lives.
So what are you doing to give back?
Well, some of it is in purely philanthropic, and some of it is philanthropic investing. So with my brother, Mark, we've funded quite a few biotech companies that are working on cures for important diseases, cancer, several different types of cancer.
Well, I'm certainly thankful that you're doing all of this research, and you've created so many helpful things that impact my life directly. You are the co-founder of Bublup, which is a cloud-based software. I like to explain it to people. It's like a combination of Pinterest and Google Drive. So it's very visually easy to use, but it also has all of the features that you would need, like in Google Drive, kind of, for those that aren't familiar with it. If you don't know what it is, you should download. It's actually free to download. And there's different levels of storage space that you can purchase. Why did you decide to get into that whole thing?
So the idea was, like with many entrepreneurs, I think to relate back to entrepreneurship, I think what a lot of entrepreneurs rightfully think about when they want to start a business is either because they stumbled on it, or it was something that was very present in their life, or they noticed that other people were having some kind of a problem, some kind of improvement that was possible. I was thinking about something that I wasn't completely satisfied with. And I felt, for me, with Bublup, the initial thought was that this activity that we perform online all the time, which is a cycle of like searching for information and then trying to save it somehow, hang on to it, and then maybe sharing it with other people. And that cycle is not satisfactory, because the reason it's not satisfactory is each of those things is separate.
It's kind of disorganized. And I think Bublup made that whole process really easy. And that's why I use it every day. Like literally, I'm not even exaggerating every day.
What Bublup does also, besides having very powerful features for organizing it, is to try to make it intuitive by making it very visual. So you have pictures associated with everything. And so,
and that's why I like to explain it as a kind of like Pinterest, right? In a way, visually.
Right. Visually, it's a lot like Pinterest because pictures are the way you identify things, right? But then when you dig into those things, you can put any kind of information. So you can put documents, you can put web links, you can put photos, you can put your own notes. So it's anything you want. So what it tends to do is to get you to think about your organization in terms of topics. Another thing I didn't even mention with Bublup is the name. The reason for the name is that—
Oh yes, please, share.
All of the content you save, as long as it's public content, we never look at your private content, okay? As long as you save public content, like a web page, okay? Because it's public anyway, all right? We will look at that content and we'll give you suggestions based on the fact that you've saved that in your folder.
So what would you say is one thing that has made you successful, like the top thing?
Knowing why you want to do this that you are doing right now. Always have a clear connection with your reasons for having this business. Why? Because you're going to run into a lot of problems. And as you run into those problems, and you're going to have a lot of days where you're saying, why am I even doing this?
Oh my God, yeah.
Just go get a job where somebody else makes the decisions and I just have to do what I'm asked to do.
It's so much easier, but it's so less satisfying.
Well, there's that satisfaction, but you have to know, like, why am I doing it? Maybe you're doing it just because you want to prove it to yourself, and that is important. That's okay. But if you can figure out the top one, two, or three reasons why you are doing this, and always keep them in your mind, write them down, put them on a bulletin board, something, you know, have a note somewhere. And just remember, I'm connected to this for a reason. And hopefully that motivation stays with you the whole journey, because it's going to be important. Otherwise, that's kind of like your seatbelt when you get into a bumpy surface.
Right. Otherwise, you can veer off the road and go in the wrong direction.
Yeah, you got to have your compass, right? So right. I would say number one thing is have your compass.
100%. That's very, very important. What's one thing that you learned along the way that you wish you knew when you started?
The part about really, truly understanding my market. You know, like I feel like you can never do enough research. I think like sometimes it's too easy to just go on your gut feeling and feel like people are gonna want this, people are gonna like this, and not ask enough other people for their input on that.
What is one piece of advice that you would give to an aspiring entrepreneur?
I would say that you are going to meet many people in your journey as an entrepreneur. You are going to work with probably investors, unless you already have your own capital. You are going to have employees, and you are going to have customers. And all of those people are going to want to know what your business is about and what makes it special and what makes it interesting and why it provides value. And that means that you have to be on point and you have to be articulate about answering that question when anybody asks.
Well, that is very helpful. This has been so eye-opening and informative. And I just feel like I'm going to go and start a billion-dollar company right now. So thank you so much for speaking to me today and to sharing your advice with all of us here. So it's just been wonderful having you on the show, Alain.
Thank you so much. It's been an honor to be on the show. And let me know what your billion-dollar idea is, because I want to invest.
Oh, well then, I sure will.
Thank you so
as
much.
As soon as I think of it and do a lot of research and ask a lot of people.
Yeah.
And make sure I have all of the things you just said.
Be ready to answer all my questions.
Oh, I'm going to be so ready for it.
Thank you so much.
And thank you to everyone who tuned in today. If you want to learn more about Bublup, you can go to bublup.com. And that is all for this edition of School of Hustle. Now, if you want to check out our other episodes, you can watch them on YouTube, or you can listen on Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you can stream and download podcasts. And if you like what you heard, please consider sharing with a friend and leaving a review. I'm going to see you next time. Thanks for watching. Bye.